Everyone, welcome back to Shades of Radiology. Today I am going to discuss about the anatomy of CT temporal bone, as simple as that. So let us see. Before going to temporal bone, always it is must and should to look in the three planes, that is the axial, the coronal and the sagittal planes, because the various structures, various small and tiny structures are visible in three planes, in three different planes, with few structures are seen in different planes. So first coming to three ossicles, that is the malleus, incus and stapes. So these are the three ossicles with their anatomical parts labeled. In the axial section, you can remember the ossicles in as the ice cream cone appearance, two dots and two dashes. So if you are seeing these three in three different planes, it means the ossicles are intact and they are in place. So this is the head of the malleus and this is the incus, giving ice cream cone appearance, and this is the foot plate of stapes. You can see the anterior and posterior limbs of stapes to the oval window here, and here you can see the malleus head and this is the incus. You can see the tympanic membrane very well. And you can see the 7th renal nerve mastoid portion. Coming to the two dots, you always can see the two dots and the two dashes. So if you are seeing all these three, that is the ice cream cone appearance, the two dots and two dashes, all the ossicles are present and they are intact and they are in place. So this is the anatomy of middle ear cavity. You can see various structures labeled, which is given in RSNA journal. You can go through the various structures. You can see the cochlear promontory very well. You can see the cochlear promontory. This is the tympanic membrane and the stapes, which is getting attached to the wall window here, and the tympanic segment of the facial nerve. So various structures can be seen. This is the cochlea. You can see the basal turn and middle and apical turns. So coming to the cochlea. Cochlea, congenital anomalies of cochlea are very common, and we need to identify whether cochlea is present or absent. So always look for the presence of the cochlea and the modulus. You can see the three, the basal turn and the apical turns. You can see the basal turn and the apical turn, which is separated again by the scala, media and tympani. You can see the bone structures and it appears like a stack of coins. So presence of these three layers indicates that the cochlea is present and its normal cochlear turns are completely present. Coming to three semicircular canals, when you come from above, when you are scrolling from temporal bone in the axial plane, the first thing which we encounter is the superior semicircular canal, and when you go down gradually, we will get a horizontal semicircular canal or lateral semicircular canal, which is given the name as the signet ring appearance on the axial plane. You can see this is the ring, this is the vestibule, and this is the lateral semicircular canal giving a signet ring appearance, and when you go down, you can see the posterior semicircular canal. So these are the three semicircular canals which you should look for the presence, and also look for the dehiscence in the coronal planes, whether there is any semicircular canal dehiscence which can lead to vertigo and imbalance. Coming to oval window and round window, you can see the oval window, which the foot plate of the stapes is the anterior and the posterior limb of the stapes, and getting attached to the oval window. And the important thing which we need to remember when you are looking at the stapes is the fissula anteri fenestrum. Look for the lytic areas or the sclerotic areas in this region, which is always rule out otosclerosis. There are various stages of otosclerosis, but you should look for the lytic areas and sclerotic areas in this region. The first region to be involved is the fissula anteri fenestrum. Coming to the facial nerve and canal, there are various segments of the facial nerve which, unless we scroll through the images, you cannot see the entire facial nerve. And this is a very good image. You can see the entire facial nerve coils in the temporal bone, which is depicted in the oblique curved coronal reconstructed image. You can see the mastoid portion, the tympanic segment, and the geniculate ganglion, the labyrinthine segment, and the internal auditory canal. It arises from the brainstem going into the internal auditory canal to the labyrinthine segment initially. Then you can see a turn, geniculate ganglion, and then the tympanic segment through the tympanic cavity and the roof. Along the medial wall, you can see the facial nerve, and then the mastoid segment and exits through the stylomastoid foramen. So we need to look for the entire facial nerve canal presence and also the erosions in case of cholesteatoma or CSOM. And also sometimes the very rare entity called as congenital absence of facial nerve, the facial nerve canal will be completely absent. Coming to the external auditory canal and the tympanic membrane, you can see the bony portion and the cartilaginous portion of the external auditory canal. And you can see the thin tympanic membrane, which is intact, and there is no any perforation, there is no any defect, and there is no any thickening. So you need to look for all these things. Look for any sclerosis of the external auditory canal through load surface here. Look for exostosis arising from external auditory canal and congenital conditions like external auditory canal atresia. Coming to mastoids, which is very important, always look for the how well the mastoids are pneumatized, whether it is normal pneumatization or hyper pneumatization. You can see the mastoid here, the air cells are completely pneumatized till the petrous apex. This petrous apex pneumatization is of very important, and if then there is an infected mastoid air cells, it can lead to the carotid canal involvement and can lead to involvement of the ICA. So always look at the hyper pneumatization and pneumatization of petrous apex. This petrous unilateral pneumatization of petrous apex can mimic an abnormality in case of MR images, because on one side the petrous apex shows the normal fatty marrow and on the other side air cells will be present. So when there is an asymmetric petrous apex pneumatization, always be aware of pathology, whether it is a normal one or the abnormal one. Coming to internal auditory canal, look at the size, always compare bilaterally and symmetrically whether there is any enlargement. In case of acoustic schwannomas, there will be a widening of the bony internal auditory canal. So the 7th and 8th cranial nerves pass through these internal auditory canal, and most common is the schwannomas, which cause the enlargement of internal auditory canal. And the most important is the fracture mimics. We need to importantly remember these three types, that is extrinsic sutures, intrinsic fissures, and intrinsic channels. The extrinsic fissures include three, that is the squenosquamosal suture, the petro-occipital suture, and the occipitomastoid suture. So these are very commonly seen in thin sections, which should not be confused with the fracture. And the intrinsic fissures like petromastoid suture, tympanosquamous suture, which is bilateral and always symmetrical, and the petrotympanic suture. And coming to intrinsic channels like cingular canal, cochlear aqueduct, which is very thin structure, and the petromastoid canal. All these sutures, fissures, and intrinsic channels are very well appreciated in higher MDCTs, that is like 64 slice or 128 slice MDCTs. And the pathologies where what you need to look for is in the external auditory canal, look for the cholesteatoma, keratosis obturans, and malignant otitis externa, especially in case of diabetics, and neoplastic lesions like squamous cell carcinomas. And middle ear cavity, the most common is the otitis media, cholesteatoma, and congenital cholesterol granulomas. And the neoplastic lesions of middle ear cavity, always look for the glomus tympanicum and choristoma. And facial nerve, Bell's palsy, you can see when there is any lesion or adjacent to the facial canal can cause Bell's palsy. And neoplastic lesions like schwannoma, involvement of the facial nerve schwannoma can be present sometimes, which can lead to the focal enlargement of the facial nerve canal. And coming to petrous apex, look for the petrous apicitis. Like I have already mentioned, the asymmetric pneumatization of petrous apexes is very important. And look for the cholesterol granuloma in the petrous apex, and few lesions which can occur along the petrous apex are the meningioma, chondrosarcoma, chordoma, metastasis, and various other neoplastic lesions. Thank you very much.